بالعالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق أجمعين محمد وأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. We discussed in the previous lecture about performing wudu, how to perform wudu, and we explained the important points of washing the face and washing the hands and wiping. There was only one inquiry from some of the students that when we wipe the feet, are we allowed to put our hand on the feet and then wipe it? Well, according to some ulama, I said it's allowed, you know, you put your hand and then you wipe, you know. But some still said it's better to start from the tip of the toes and then you wipe, you know. So to cover ideas of both of them, maybe that is the best way. Otherwise, still they said if you put your hand and then wipe is regarded as starting from the toe till the ankle joint. These are general questions which are there and people need to know about it. What we discuss is when you use water, tap water by hand and you wash. Sometimes, for any reason, one cannot use his right hand or left hand for washing the other parts. And here, they can use what we call it wudu by immersion, immerging the part of the body inside the water. That is possible, allowed, not necessary by hand to put and wash. So if you have a fountain of water, and for any reason I cannot use, well, even if I can use, that is allowed. Another way of washing by immersion or irtimasi. But the way to do it, again, we have to start, if we have to wash the face, has to be from up, down, you know. Not I put first the chin and then the rest of the face, so the washing will be reversed, which is not allowed. So I have to put first the forehead, and then I move it inside the water, so it will wash all the way, but starting from the forehead till the chin. And to wash the right hand in immersion, again, we have to put it from the elbow joint first in the water, and then gradually we keep all of it in water and then we take it out. So the washing in this way started from elbow to the tips of the finger. Because some used to say that, you see, it's difficult to do it. They said you immerse your hand first in water and when you take it out, you have intention of wudu. When you immerse it, there is no intention of wudu. And he said, for every act, intention is important. So wudu, there is intention. So when you dip your hand in the water, there is no intention of wudu. But then when you take it out, it will come out first the elbow joint and then the fingers. So you have intention of wudu. But according to Ayatollah Sistani, this is not allowed. He said, you immerse first your elbow joint in the fountain of water, and then rest of the hand, and then bring it out. Here, well, when you bring it out, naturally water will run from the hand, from the forearm to the hand. According to Ayatollah Sistani, is okay, but maybe according to others, is not okay. As we said, the remaining water of the hand, with that we have to wipe the forehead. So usually they advise that when you take your hand out, do not keep it up down so the water will flow from forearm. You keep it at the straight level so the water will not flow. So whatever water is here will remain, and whatever water in the forearm will remain in the forearm. And again, to do wudu for the left hand, again, this is still more problematic, to mix the water with the water of the hand. And if it is done, again, one should not keep it up down so the water will flow. But when you take it out of the let us say ocean of water or fountain of water, you keep it straight so the water of the forearm will fall on the ground and water of the hand will fall. So whatever remains is the same water of wudu. That is possible, and sometimes one needs it, especially if he has some pain or injury in the hand and he cannot wash it by hand, you find it difficult. So in that case, he can use this, what you call, irtimasi way, and it is allowed. That is the issue about it. I mean, of course, this is discussed from issue 267 up to 269. From issue 270 to, all that issue is a long issue, he is discussing about recommended supplications. It's good to remember them by heart. So when you see the water, there is a supplication to recite. And when you do gargling by mouth, that is recommended. Or when you sneeze water three times, that is recommended, not obligatory. And then when you wash your face, there is a supplication. When you wash right hand, there is a supplication. When you wash left hand, there is another supplication. When you wipe your forehead, so all are small supplications. Their meanings are very beautiful, very nice. It's good to remember them and to recite them at time of performing wudu. Then we come to a new subject, and that is conditions for the validity of wudu. There are many conditions mentioned here that the wudu will be valid, and all these conditions should be observed. Said the first condition is that the water should be tahir and clean, not sullied with dirt, even if that dirt is tahir. The second condition is that the water should be pure and not mixed. You see, the first one, you said the water is to be tahir. Now, if the water itself is najis, naturally is not suitable for performing wudu. Sometimes the water is not najis, but is mixed with dirt. Let us say, as we said, urine of those animals whose meat is allowed is tahir. Let us say, goat or like that, its urine is tahir, but is dirty. Okay, tahir, fine, but is not liked. So now if you have little water and mixed with that urine, even if it is tahir, but it is not good, you know. So he said, even with that, you are not allowed to perform wudu. So though with the clean, nice, good water, if too much clay and dust and all that mixed, you know, okay, maybe the dust is tahir, you know, but then it doesn't look clean. Clean against dirty. Not clean means purify. It may be purified, but not really clean. So you say with that water, not allowed. You may wait, let us say, I mean, if it is big water, until the dirt will come down and the water above become a clean water, then to perform wudu with that is all right. Otherwise, when it is mixed with dirt, that is not allowed. The second condition, you said the water should be pure and not mixed, because, as we said, it should be the wudu to be performed with water, not with orange juice, let us say, or with rose water, for example, and similar things. All those are not allowed. It is a mixed water. In issue 271, he said the wudu performed with a najis thing is void, so that wudu is not allowed, and we should not accept it. It should be with a proper, pure water. And if somebody offer a prayer with that wudu, naturally, if the wudu is batil, is void, then the prayer is void, so his prayer is not right, and he has to repeat it. So the water to be used has to be tahir water and not and pure water, not mixed water. If there is a short time and we had only water which is mixed with mud, I mean to say sometimes in villages, not always, like in cities, water is available. And if he has to wait till water settles, then maybe the time for a prayer, let us say morning prayer, the time is tight. Then in that case, he has to do it tayammum. He performed tayammum. We are going to discuss what is tayammum. He has to do tayammum for that. or if he has time, then he will wait till the dirt will settle and then above the water remains clean, so he can perform with that one. So these are two conditions. We come to the third condition, is that the water should be mubah. Mubah means permissible to use, not usurped from others, you know. That is the word mubah. So if the water we are using, if I usurp water from somebody and perform wudu with that, the wudu is void, not allowed. The water that I am using, it should be permissible to use that water. Now this happens when practically? Okay, at home, okay, the water is my water, no problem. But if I go to house of somebody, and let us say he is obsessive, he doesn't want somebody to go to his bathroom and use the bathroom because he believes bathroom will get infection or dirty. Some people are obsessive like that. So here, if he is not knowing and I go and I use that, that's not allowed because I'm misusing the water. A second condition like that, if we go to certain mosques, in each mosque usually there is a bathroom and there is a place for performing wudu. Now some people, when they make the mosque as a trust for sake of God in order to get reward from God, they say whoever use these bathrooms and use the water, he should offer a prayer in the mosque so that I will get some reward. Otherwise, if he go to bathroom and then perform wudu and go home, pray somewhere else, so what thawab or what reward I am getting? So they put a condition that. So in that case, if one goes to such places where it is known that this water is used for people to perform wudu and pray in this mosque, then it is not allowed. Otherwise, he has to pray at least 2 rak'at prayer, and then if he want to leave, he can leave. But in certain mosques, practically you see the people are using it and there is no one. No one means no, the one who is a trustee of the mosque or the servant who is taking care of the mosque on behalf of the trustee. Nobody will tell the people that, okay, be aware that whoever used this water, he has to pray in the mosque. Then it's all right, you know, because generally or practically is known that people can perform wudu, because by performing wudu, still there is reward for the original donor or original person who made it as a trust. Because people are using his water for performing wudu, and with that wudu they offer prayer, even if not in that mosque, somewhere else or at home, but still they performed wudu with his water, and that is a good cause, you know, it's a type of charity. So some people make it open for everybody. And if it practically looks like open, nobody prevent the people from performing wudu unless they offer a prayer. So it's taken granted that it is okay. Another situation in religious schools. I mean, these are, probably not in the Western countries, but these are in cities like Qom or Najaf, where there are so many religious schools, and the people from the market, they go inside the religious school and they have a fountain of water, they perform wudu and offer their prayer maybe in their shop or if there is a mosque nearby, and that mosque does not have facility of water, so they perform wudu in the school. He said again the same question, if the trustee of that school said that this water to be used by students of the school, it is like a dormitory, So that is for that only, then it is okay. If it is not, then we are not allowed. Let us say in the Western countries, if you go to a places like, let us say, restaurants or similar place, and if that is not made for public, made only for those who are taking food in that restaurant, then in that case you cannot use the water unless you get permission. You can tell them that, okay, I want to use the toilet, I want to use the water, the wash basin, to wash. I mean, they may not know wudu, but they say, I want to wash my face and hands. So if they say allowed, and they say it is okay, I mean, even for public they are allowed to come. After all, if today you are not my customer, you will be my customer later on, so no problem. That facility is open, then it is permissible to use. But if it is restricted to certain groups, then we should not use that. So here, what you say, the water has to be mubah or permissible to use, not that water owned by some people and we usurp it from them and perform wudu. In that case, that is not allowed. So this is the third point, and the issues after that is discussed about the fourth condition. Is that the container of the water used by the person concerned for wudu should be permissible as well. So if I have a container to take water and perform wudu with that water, that container also should not be usurped. I do not usurp it from my colleague or a friend or somebody and I perform wudu, I return it. He say no, you should be allowed to use that. You see, Islam is very precise about rights of others. So even to take a glass of water from somebody and without his permission and to perform wudu with that without his permission, if it is usurped, they say your wudu is void, you cannot perform that. The fifth condition is said as an obligatory precaution, the container of the water used for wudu should not be made of gold or silver. So there are some details mentioned here in the issue 279. Well, hardly now there are containers for made of gold and silver, but if they are made of gold and silver, he said should not be used as an obligatory precaution for wudu. Now, the sixth condition is that part of the wadi on which wudu is performed should be tahir at the time of washing and wiping. Now, the parts of wudu are the face, the two hands, the forehead, and the two feet. These are the parts of wudu. Now, they have to be tahir. I mean, if they are contaminated with blood, with urine, with stool, with, let us say, wine, or alcohol, if alcohol is najis, according to some ulama, with any najis thing, if they are contaminated, should be washed before you perform wudu tahir. Well, should they be washed before I start with wudu or before I start washing that organ? He said no, before starting washing that organ. For example, I am washing my face, and then I notice that my hand touched somewhere which is najis. My wudu is all right because I have not reached that. I can, meanwhile, make a tahir. So when I use to wash my right hand, and then when I reach the left hand, still my hand, there is a time to reach it, and when I reached it, it was already made tahir. I washed it under tap water. So he said, any part to be washed has to be tahir at that time. Here is again a practical problem or important issue. Using odor colognes or some type of perfumes which has alcohol. As you know, there are two views of the ulama about alcohol. Some said alcohol are not the wine which is najis, so they are tahir. Some said no, alcohol, because they can make the drunken case, and it is concentration of wine, which is, well, 99% concentrated. So they are najis. So here, if somebody following in taqlid of one of the maraja who said it is tahir, still it is always better that he wash the places of wudu. I mean, make sure his hand, make sure his face are tahir before he start wudu, to cover a view of all maraja. Because in the future, let us say after 20, 30 years, if, God forbid, the marja he follow dies, and then he do taqlid of another marja, and that one said, no, alcohol is najis. Now I performed wudu when parts of my body were najis, and I was not realizing it was najis because fatwa of the marja in those days was tahir. Probably he will say, you have to repeat your prayer for all those 20 years because your wudu were batil, were void. You perform wudu with najis thing, though you did not know it is najis, or you believed it is tahir. See, it is it is not wajib for you, but practically you might face that problem. So it's always better that to make sure parts of wudu which are to be washed or to be wiped should be tahir before you start the wudu. I mean, if you don't know the oil you are using, the Vaseline you are using, or any type of ointment you are using, you don't know it is tahir or najis. It is regarded as tahir, no doubt. But if after 10 years you discover that they use, let us say, animal fat in it or pig fat in it, and then now you perform wudu when your lips, for example, you put ointment, or your face or your hand was najis, now then you see you have to repeat the prayer of all those days when your wudu was batil and you didn't know, you did not realize. So it's always better as a personal precaution, that you make sure parts of the wudu are completely tahir. To use any sort of thing which is doubtful, maybe tahir, maybe najis, of course, from point of taharat, it's tahir, unless you know it is najis. But what I mean, you use it other parts, because if your dress was najis and you did not know, then your prayer is all right. But if your hands were najis and you did not know and you perform wudu, your wudu is void. And if the wudu is void, the prayer is void. So you see, with wudu, one should be more sure that his wudu is all right. The dress, okay, if you do not know, your dress is najis and you are not aware of it, and after the prayer you find that your dress is najis because of blood or anything, your prayer is all right. But if you perform wudu and there is a blood and you didn't know and you perform wudu, naturally blood is najis, and then after the prayer you realize that, oh, there was a dried blood and I had injury and I was not aware of it, your wudu is batil. So you see, that is the difference. So what I mean, in places of wudu, I mean the face, the right hand, left hand, and your forehead and the feet, better, I don't say obligatory, it's better to make it tahir, make sure they are tahir before performing wudu. So that in the future, if you realize you are using some ointment or some perfume or alcohol or some types of food, then later on you find in its contents there are some animal fat which is not halal fat and so on. So at least your wudu is all right and your prayer is all right. So that is important. So this point here, he mentions that that all parts of the body to be washed or wiped at time of wudu should be tahir. And these are some practical applications that I have mentioned already. Come to seventh condition, that the person doing wudu should have sufficient time at his disposal for wudu and prayer. You see, this happens sometime one is awake in the morning and you find only 5 minutes for sunrise. Now if you go and perform wudu, it may take him 5 minutes, then the sunrise, and he will miss the prayer. There he must perform tayammum if possible. I mean, tayammum, you should have, let us say, sand or clay at home, and tayammum is done very fast. We'll discuss it in detail, but then you hit the hand there and then wipe the forearm and then wipe your hands. And that one time, second time is recommended. So it is in a, let us say, half a minute you can perform tayammum and then you offer your prayer. So you see, if the time is tight, then your duty will change from wudu to tayammum. And if the time is tight, you are not allowed to perform wudu, otherwise wudu is void here. Why void? Because you say wudu, the intention of wudu, you say qurbatan ila Allah ta'ala. I perform wudu for the sake of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it is my duty to offer prayer, and before the prayer I have to perform wudu. So it is my duty for sake of Allah. But now Allah told you, your duty is not wudu, your duty is tayammum, because the time is tight for the prayer. So we say for sake of God, it is not for sake of God. It is for your mistake you did it. Because your duty is to perform tayammum. So that is why he said it is not allowed in that case. But sometimes if the time for wudu and tayammum is same, till I go and find where I kept the clay or the sand and I bring it and open it, and then I perform, it will take a long time because it may not be ready in my hand. So the same, okay, in that case one perform wudu. Here in wudu, intention is important, of course, as for all religious acts. So intention of wudu, it is two types, let us say. Either I say I perform wudu in order to offer my prayer. So here the wudu is for the prayer, and that has to be when the time of the prayer started. I mean, if it is midday prayer, at midday, not at 10 o'clock morning. 10 o'clock morning, there is no prayer. So I can't say I perform wudu for midday prayer, when midday prayer, let us say 1 o'clock, and now it is 10 o'clock morning. So the intention should be I perform wudu for generally for sake of God, because it is recommended that you are on a state of taharat always. Actually, it will increase sustenance of the person who, if he perform wudu before going outside for his business or for school or study or anywhere, that I remain always on a state of taharat with wudu is recommended, whether there is a prayer or no prayer, immaterial. So if I perform wudu for the sake of God, then it is okay, generally. But if I perform wudu for the prayer, then it should be time of the prayer, because that is for the prayer. So practically, again, I say it is always better to get used to it, that you perform wudu generally for sake of God, to be on a state of what you call taharat, purifying, spiritual purity. So that is perform wudu. Now, whether it is time of a prayer or not time, or time is tight or not tight, or I pray the prayer on time or pray it qadha later on, that is immaterial, because your intention was just to be on a state of a spiritual purification. So that is your intention. So these points are important to be remembered. Yes. Now, the eighth condition is that one should perform wudu with the intention of qurbat, to obey the order of Allah. If a person performs wudu for the purpose of cooling himself or for some other purpose, the wudu would be void. As we say, the intention has to be for sake of Allah. But now, if the weather is hot and I perform wudu just to get cooling, then it is not for sake of God and is not accepted. So it has to be for that. Of course, one can perform wudu and can, after wudu, wash his face 10 times to get cooled. That is fine, But when he perform wudu, it should be for the sake of Almighty God, The intention, this is issue 288, he said the intention does not mean that you have to say it by tongue, I perform wudu for the sake of Almighty God. No, it's not necessary. Just you know what you are doing, that means the intention. That You are here. If somebody asks you, what are you doing? You will not say that, oh, I don't know. I just came. You say, no, I came here to perform wudu for sake of God. So that you know what you are doing. That is intention. Otherwise, not necessary to say it by tongue, even not necessary to remember it, I mean, to utter it by mind, you know, that by, in your mind, you say, I perform wudu, even not by tongue, by mind, that is not necessary. That you know what you are doing, that is the intention. So he said, you know, and that is all. You know that you are performing wudu for the sake of God, and that's all. The ninth condition of wudu, it should be performed in the prescribed sequence, that in the first face should be washed, and then right hand, and then left hand. So we said in wudu, his sequence is important. If somebody starts washing the right hand, and then he remembered he did not wash the face, he go back and wash the face, this is not allowed. So he should start with washing the face, then washing the right hand, then washing the left hand, then wiping the forehead, and then about the feet, well, the right feet first and the left feet second. If you do it reverse, not allowed. But if you do it simultaneously, some ulama said allowed, some ulama said according to precaution, not allowed. So let us say practically always better to wipe the right feet first and then left feet second to cover the views of ulama, all of them. So that sequence is important. The ninth condition, that wudu, which formed in consequence, the tenth, the act of wudu should be done one after the other in succession. In succession means that should be no gap of time between washing one part, washing the face, let us say, and the right hand. So suppose you washed your face and a telephone comes and then you go and want to hear who is in the telephone, and you talk for 2 minutes and come back and you see the face is dried and the time has passed, say that is not allowed. So he said there should be a succession, one after the other. Okay, little time, maybe 5 seconds, 10 seconds is okay, as long as it is wet, still wet, and then you shift if you want to move or for some emergency or take something fall down and so on. So that is okay, no problem. But to wait for a long time, which till the part of the body dried up, that is not allowed, you know. So succession is important, that one after the other to be done continuously, yes. Well, here there are many issues about that, but generally, they talk about this point that succession should be there. You know. Now, the 11th condition is that a person doing wudu should wash his hands and face and wipe his head and feet himself, not done by somebody else. You know, one should perform wudu by himself. Now, if somebody else take water and wash my face, that is not allowed. And this is in a normal situation. Now, if I am sick and I cannot raise my hand, okay, if possible, he raise my hand and he let me do it with my own hand. And then he do the intention and I do both. We do intention of wudu. I have intention of wudu for myself and he has intention of wudu for me. But he use my hand. Now, if somebody is too ill and too sick and he cannot perform that, and maybe tayammum also cannot be performed for any reason, then somebody else will wash his hand, still allowed, but that is, I said, is only in state of emergencies. Otherwise, in a normal situation, one should perform wudu, washing the hand, the face, the hands, by himself, not by somebody else. Well, the 12th condition is that there should be no constraint for using water. Now, if the water is harmful for me and I am not allowed medically to use the water, then I should not use the water. Islam cares for health of the people. And if I know that wudu for any medical reason not allowed, then I should not. I say, okay, no, still I will use water, no problem. He said, no, that is not allowed and the wudu will be void. If it is harmful, then you should not perform wudu with water. It will change into tayammum, because tayammum is in such places when the using of the water is harmful to the body. And here there are still many points about it, but we'll come to the 13th condition, is that there should be no impediment in the way of water reaching the parts of wudu. What is meant here, that we wash the parts of the body with water and the water should reach. So if there is, let us say, plaster which prevent water, we should remove it before. If there are little nail polish, we have to remove it, you know. So any obstacle there, some people who are working, let us say, with a car and there is a grease and dirt there, then they have to clean the grease before so it will reach the skin to perform wudu. If somebody is working with a clay or cement, and again some part of a clay or cement remains on his body, naturally he has to remove it because that prevents water from reaching the skin. He should clean his hand, his face before he performs wudu, so the water will reach there. Other question comes, what about little dirt below the nails? Now, say if the nail is a usual in size, and that is regarded under the nail, not covering the skin, it is okay, because that is not to be washed under the nail. You have to wash the skin. But if the nail is too long, and the dirt is in such a place where it is to be washed, so it has to be cleaned completely so that water will reach that. So that is a point to be known about that dirt, because many people they ask, and that to be clear for them. So here we said that the water should reach the skin directly. If there is a cloth, well, we have to remove it. Or if something, then the water should go below and touch the skin and wash the skin itself. Another practical problem happens when there is little superficial injury, when the skin, flap of the skin is out. Is that wajib to wash below it or not? The part of it, part of the wound, if it is regarded at depth, not external part, then it is not wajib to wash. We said we wash whatever external part, not inside. But if the flap is small and below the flap is regarded as external, so I should cut that skin, take it out, so that below it I can wash it. Or if it is there, I have to wash below that, you know. This is again another practical matter which people might face. So these are the general points about the wudu and how to perform it in the right way. And it will finish till issue 304, and then we will start rules regarding wudu, inshallah, in the next session. Walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa alihi al-tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alihi.